Hare Krishna, welcome to this episode of Bhagavad Gita. Today's verse is chapter 4, text 36, the rescue boat of knowledge. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya. Chakshurunmilitam yena tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam sthapitam yena bhutale. Svayam rupah kadamahyam dadati svapadantikam. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha. Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tamsajivam. Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhan Vitamscha. He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanusute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. Namo Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda. Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So welcome to this episode of Bhagavad Gita. Today's verse is chapter 4, text 36. And the topic is the rescue boat of transcendental knowledge. Let's chant word by word and then line by line. Please repeat after me. Api Chet Asi Papebhyah Sarvebhyah Papakrittamah Sarvam Jnana Plavena Eva Vrijinam Santarishyasi. Line by line. Api Chedasi Papebhyah Sarvebhyah Papakrittamah Sarvam Jnana Plavenaiva Vrijinam Santarishyasi. Api Chetasi Papebhyah Sarvebhyah Papakrittamah Sarvam Jnana Plavenaiva Vrijinam Santarishyasi. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Api, even, chet, if, asi, you are, papebhyah, of sinners, sarvebhyah, of all, papakrittamah, the greatest sinner, sarvam, all such sinful reactions, jnanaplavena, by the board of transcendental knowledge, eva, certainly, vrijinam, the ocean of miseries, santarishyasi, you will cross completely. Translation, even if you are considered to be the most sinful of all sinners, when you are situated on the board of transcendental knowledge, you will be able to cross over the ocean of miseries. Purport. Proper understanding of one's constitutional position in relationship to Krishna is so nice that it can at once lift one from the struggle for existence which goes on in the ocean of nations. This material world is sometimes regarded as an ocean of nations and sometimes as a blazing forest. In the ocean, however expert a swimmer one may be, the struggle for existence is very severe. If someone comes forward and lifts the struggling swimmer from the ocean, he is the greatest savior. Perfect knowledge received from the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the path of liberation. The boat of Krishna consciousness is very simple, but at the same time the most sublime. So, papebhya. We all are sinners in this material world. Everyone is a sinner. From Brahma down to the ant, everyone is a sinner in this material world, and that's why we are in this material world. If we were not sinners, we would have been in the spiritual world, never to come here. So there are some living entities who are called Nitya Siddha. Nitya Siddha means they never commit any sin. They did not commit any mistake. And those souls are occupying the spiritual planets, Vaikuntha planets. So whoever are in this material world, whoever is in this material world is the sinner. So just like in a prison house, whoever is there is more or less a criminal. But there are people who never committed a crime and they never entered into the prison house. They don't know how a prison house looks like. So that is the kind of people, the souls who are in the Vaikuntha Loka. They never came into this material world. So the others, that means us who are in this material world, we are all papebhya. So we may think that we are very big devotees and, you know, big this and big that, but actually we all are sinners. Maybe it's a A class prison or a B class prison or a C class prison, but it's prison nonetheless. So prison means there is punishment. Maybe lesser degree, greater degree, that varies, but punishment is always there. Therefore, no matter how one is comfortable or not, maybe with riches, maybe with education, maybe with beauty, maybe a cultured family or a good nation, whatever it may be, these may be conveniences compared to, you know, poverty, a lack of education and all these things. But neither, that means the one who is so-called comfortable or the one who is so-called not comfortable, neither of them can escape the miseries of birth, death, old age and disease. Just like A-class prisoner, B-class prisoner, C-class prisoner. Yes, the degree of punishment may be different for these three, but they cannot go out of the walls of the prison. So that is common for all. How strenuous or not the punishment may be, the confinement is for all classes of prisoners. So similarly, we are all confined in this material world, papebhya. Papa means sinful activity, and papebhya means one who has committed sinful activity. So here, in this verse, it is explained, api chedasi papebhyah sarvebhyah papakrittamah. Even if one is most sinful, papakrit tamah, tamah means superlative degree. Papakrit means one who is a sinful person. Papakrit taraha means one who is more sinful. Papakrit tamah means one who is most sinful. सुपरलेटिव डिग्री. सो ईवन इफ वन इज द मोस्ट सिंफुल इफ ही गेट्स ऑन टू द बोट ऑफ ट्रांसेंडेंटल नॉलेज ही विल क्रॉस ओवर द ओशन ऑफ मेटीरियल एग्जिस्टेंस. सो समटाइम्स as Srila Prabhupada many times mentioned that when Srila Prabhupada came to India with his Western disciples, then the Orthodox Brahmins, they were not happy with him. They were thinking, oh, how can these sinful rascals, you know, how can they come into this, and what is this, you know, this is contaminating the whole Hinduism. They were thinking like that. And they don't understand, but that first of all, by identifying like that with the body, they are already contaminated. They have fallen. The thing is that, who is not a sinner? You mean the Brahmanas are not sinners? I mean, they are not supposed to be. But what about the Brahmanas in Kali Yuga? It's not that Brahmana is sinless. Sinless means only a devotee. Only he is sinless. So even a Brahmana, as long as we are in this material world, within the three modes of material nature, we are facing the reactions of our past sinful activities. Otherwise, we will not take repeated birth. We would never have taken a birth in this material world otherwise. So the very fact that we have taken birth means that we have sinned. Okay? So sarvebhya papakritamaha, even if he is most sinful, he should be welcome into the ocean, into the boat of transcendental knowledge. He should be rescued. That is real compassion. Not that, oh, he's very sinful, let him drown. No, rescue him. This is compassion. So that is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission as well. He does not see the distinction whether this, even that nice song of Nityananda Prabhu, no, song of Bhaktivinoda Thakur about Nityananda Prabhu. Jati dhana vidya bala nakore apeksha. Nityananda Prabhu did not see any difference whether jati dhana vidya bala, whether he is coming from a good family or whether he has a lot of riches or he is very educated or he is very strong. Doesn't matter. There is no consideration. He distributed Harinam to everyone. Even the most sinful, Jaga and Madhai were there. They were also delivered. So that is our solace. Krishna is very kind and his devotees are also very kind. They want to save even the worst sinner. In fact, when they see worst sinner, they become even more happy. Like, this was the story of how Jaga and Madhai were delivered. So everybody was, you know, Nityananda Prabhu and Haridas Thakur, they were going door to door asking everybody to chant. And as they were preaching to one householder, they heard all this commotion on the street from outside the house. What is going on? Then the householder told, you know, this is actually Jaga and Madhai. Every time they just, you know, create a huge commotion and then they beat up people and then they get drunk, womanizers, very, very extremely sinful people. Please do not go near them. You are preaching, you know, you are going door to door, but don't touch these people. They don't deserve. Then Haridas Thakur and Nityananda Prabhu immediately thought that these two people are the most deserving candidates. Because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is called Patita Pavana Hetu Tava Avatar. He has come to reclaim the fallen souls. He did not say especially pious souls. Of course, pious souls will be, you know, whoever takes to this Sankirtan movement will become pious. Whether he was pious or whether he was sinful, he will become pious just by contacting the Sankirtan movement. So that's why he did not take any weapons. Sudarshan Chakra not there, bow and arrow not there, gada not there, sword, nothing. No weapons. Because if he starts to kill, everybody has to be killed. Of course, the killing is also delivering, but he wished to deliver in a different way. By chanting, by giving them love of Godhead. Because killing liberation means only Brahma Jyoti. But Harinam, by giving Harinam, he is giving them the wealth of devotional service, and that's how they will become, you know, devotees. So Nityananda Prabhu and Haridas Thakur thought, wow, this is perfect opportunity to glorify Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If these two are most fallen souls, then if the Harinam delivers them, then that Harinam will be known, everybody will honor the Harinam, and everybody will take to the chanting. Harinam will become even more well known. So the devotee is always thinking of how to glorify the Lord, and the Lord is also thinking how to glorify the devotee. So he places some challenges in front of the devotee, and the devotee overcomes those challenges by taking shelter of Krishna, and everybody else sees the devotee overcoming these huge, humongous challenges, and then they get inspired, and then in that way they follow the examples of such great devotees, like the Pandavas. They went through so much. Bhishmadeva said, you should not have even lived, you don't deserve to even live under those tribulations, but you were protected by Krishna. So, and now, today we are learning, Bhagavad Gita is because of the Pandavas. Arjuna is one of the Pandavas, and that was the whole subject matter. So even today we are glorifying. So the Lord sometimes places these things, these situations to glorify the devotees. And the devotee also sees some so-called reversal situation and turns it into a glorification of the Lord, a greater glorification of the Lord. That's why I feel sometimes, because I came from a Brahmin family. We do not eat meat. So for me, it's not a very big surprise that I came to this. It's not that. Of course, it's the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Not because I was a vegetarian, I came to this. No, there are so many vegetarians who are not coming. No. But of course, it's Srila Prabhupada's mercy. But I feel, when I see the, meat eaters, complete womanizers, meat eaters, drug addicts, and these kind of people becoming devotees, that, is a great spectacle to watch. That is very wonderful, because to give up all that and come to a totally different lifestyle, that's completely mind-blowing. So the effect of the holy name is magnified when these results are seen, when the transformation is so drastic. Then everybody sees everybody witnesses the power of the holy name. So many important people came to speak with Prabhupada by seeing that all the hippies have now become happies. They were rotten, people in our country, and they have become devotees now. How did you make them? How did you change? We were spending millions of dollars trying to, change these incorrigible people, but you have changed them without spending a single dollar. In fact, you collected dollars from them. And not only dollars, you collected their lives also. They gave their lives to you. So they were astonished. How is this possible? And Srila Prabhupada simply said, this is the effect of the holy name. The holy name is so powerful. When they are properly guided, Prabhupada said, all of Americans are very beautiful looking, very educated, very, aristocratic birth, very good nation. But because of lack of transcendental knowledge, the rescue boat of transcendental knowledge was missing. And they were drowning in the ocean, and they looked helpless and haggard and, beaten by Maya. But when they were, rescued by Srila Prabhupada onto the boat of transcendental knowledge, then they were blissful, and everybody was saying their faces were so bright. They looked starkly different from the Americans, the rest of the Americans. So this is the effect of becoming a devotee. So sarvebhya papakrittamaha. So Krishna also says in the 18th chapter that aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami. Sarva dharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vraja. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami masuchaha. Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me. I shall deliver you from all sinful reaction, do not fear. So he is assuring, and the same assurance is given in today's verse 436. Now, next line of that verse says, सर्वं ज्ञान प्लवेनैव. हाउ आर दीज यू नो मोस्ट सिन्फुल पीपल सेव्ड वेन दे क्लाइम ऑन टू द बोर्ड ऑफ ट्रांसेंडेंटल नॉलेज. नाउ व्हाट डज इट मीन टू बी सिचुएटेड ऑन द बोर्ड ऑफ ट्रांसेंडेंटल नॉलेज? What does it mean? What is transcendental knowledge? Let's see. Srimad Bhagavatam 1-11. Vadanti tat tattva vidas tattvam yajnanam advayam brahmeti paramatmeti bhagavaniti shabdyate. Learned transcendentalists, means those who have transcendental knowledge, learned transcendentalists who know the absolute truth, call this non-dual substance Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan. Now this is complete knowledge. Brahman is partial knowledge, Paramatma is also partial knowledge, but Bhagavan is complete knowledge. So to be situated on the boat of transcendental knowledge means to come to the Bhagavan realization. Yes, the others are also transcendental knowledge, but one is not safe yet, because he has not completely boarded the boat. He has seen the boat, he is trying to get onto the boat, but Bhagavan realization means he has got onto the boat, and not just any boat without just rocking in the ocean, that's all. No, with a very able captain, that is explained in the Srimad Bhagavatam 11-9-17. I always get mixed up with these numbers. 11-20-17. Nirdeham adyam sulabham sudurlabham plavam sukalpam गुरु कर्णधारं मयानुकूलेन नभस्वतेरितं पुमान भवाद्धिं नतरेत्सात्मः. प्लवम, यू सी, मीन्स बोट. सुकल्पम, एक्सट्रीमली वेल सूटेड फॉर दिस पर्पस. नाउ व्हाट इज द बोट? हियर इट इज सेड दिस ह्यूमन बॉडी इज द बोट. Is it the boat of transcendental knowledge? Well, if it is guided, it is a suitable boat. The human body is a suitable boat. But there's no use if just there is a suitable boat on the ocean. It's just rocking and the waves, the storms, wherever, the water is just taking the boat. That is as good as being in the sea. Slightly better maybe. Not much better, because our fall into the ocean is imminent in such a boat. So the human body is slightly better than the animal bodies, which is compared to the person who has fallen into the water. Now the human body is definitely better. We can make a solution, but we need to have a captain. When the captain comes, that's when the knowledge starts. आदौ गुर्वाश्रयं सद्धर्म पृच्छा. आदौ गुर्वाश्रयं सद्धर्म पृच्छा. ह्यूमन लाइफ इन द बिगिनिंग इट्सेल्फ वन मस्ट टेक शेल्टर ऑफ अ गुरु एंड स्टार्ट इंक्वायरिंग फ्रॉम हिम अबाउट स्पिरिचुअल लाइफ. दैट इज द बिगिनिंग ऑफ ह्यूमन लाइफ. सो ह्यूमन लाइफ इज मेंट टू बी अ लाइफ ऑफ नॉलेज. दैट्स व्हाई वी हैव स्कूल्स. अनफॉर्चुनेटली the modern schools do not represent real knowledge, they represent illusory knowledge, which is another feature of ignorance. Like there are so many people, so many charities, they go and build schools in Africa, and everybody thinks that's very good, good work, noble work. Well, if it is noble, then the countries where there are schools, they should be very, very good places, right? But you see all these so-called educated countries, they have what now? Nuclear weapons, bioweapons, chemical weapons, cyber weapons. They're just using their intelligence. In fact, what is the intelligence department of a country? Their intelligence is just to how to harm others, how to spy on others. Of course, every king needs espionage, that section is there, but they are just going overboard on this. The latest news is that some China, you know, is spying big time on all important influential people in the world. So these things, they are just, and there's another news, maybe they are saying that the Wuhan virus was, I mean this COVID-19 was probably made in a lab in China. So some people are saying like that. So you see, this is the intelligence of these people. So now somebody is building schools in Africa, but then you look at the countries who have those schools. Are they really good examples of educated people? The answer is an emphatic no. Emphatic no. They don't have any solutions. They're as ignorant of the solution as the people in Africa, the so-called tribal people. Rather, the African tribal people are much better off than the so-called educated people, because maybe they are uncultured and barbarian, whatever, but they are just keeping to themselves. They are not harming everybody else. They are not harming the ecology. They are not harming the people in the world. They are not harming the animals. There's no slaughterhouses, nothing. Maybe they are hunting for their own family and that's it. So yes, they are sinful, but they are not as sinful as, you know, the others, the so-called educated people. So we have to first, before we even start building schools and, you know, all these things, we have to see whether the countries which have the schools, are they really the examples to be followed? Are they on the boat of knowledge, really? They profess to be. What they're actually doing is this. This is what they're actually doing. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 6, Chapter 7, Text 14. Tesham kupatha deshtrinam. Kupatha means bad path, misleaders, who show the path of danger. You see, patha, kupatha desht. Patha means path. Supatha means the right path. Kupatha means the bad path. Tesham kupatha deshtrinam patatam tamase hyadha. Ye shraddadhyur vachaste vai majjantyashma plava iva. Leaders who have fallen into ignorance. Modern civilization, the so-called leaders who are trying to lead those so-called underdeveloped countries. Leaders who have fallen into ignorance and who mislead people by directing them to the path of destruction, as described in the previous verse, are in effect boarding a stone boat. And so too are those who blindly follow them. A stone boat would be unable to float in the and float in the water and would sink in the water with its passengers. Similarly, those who mislead people go to hell and their followers go with them. So instead of showing the boat of transcendental knowledge, they are showing the boat of material knowledge, which looks like a boat, but which does not do anything that a boat is supposed to do. It will not rescue. It just creates a hope and then gets us down under. So this is the problem. This is the problem. So in the name of leaders, they are misleaders. Now let us see this word kupatha. Kupatha means the path of danger or the path of destruction. Supatha. Where is the word supatha? I don't know if you remember. Agne naya supathara ye asman Vishwani deva vayunani vidvan Yuyodhyasma juhuranameno Bhuishtham te nama uktim vidhema. This is the last verse of the Ishopanishad. Supatha, by the right path. Agne naya supathara ye asman. O my Lord, as powerful as fire, O omnipotent one, Now I offer you all obeisances, falling on the ground at your feet. O my Lord, please lead me on the right path to reach you. And since you know all that I have done in the past, please free me from the reactions to my past sins, so that there will be no hindrance to my progress. Here actually the Sankirtan movement is already mentioned in this verse. Nama Uktim. Uktim means words of obeisance. Nama Uktim means words of obeisance. These can be nice shlokas, and of course the best shloka is the Hare Krishna Mahamantra, which is the word of obeisance. O Radha, O Krishna, please engage me in your service. This is the best word of obeisance. So the Sankirtan movement is already mentioned in this verse in the Ishopanishad. So this is the Supatha, to chant the holy name of the Lord. But Kupatha means it's Mayaya Paharta Jnana. It's not Jnana Plavenaiva. It's Ashma Plava. Not Jnana Plava. Ashma Plava. Ashma means what? Stone. Stone boat. Jnana Plava is the able boat which can cross us, I mean which can facilitate our crossing this ocean of material existence. But then we need the captain, the guru. Guru Karnadharam, able captain. Plavam Sukalpam Guru Karnadharam Mayanukulena Nabhasvateritam Puman Bhavabdhim Nataretsa Atmaha. The human body, which can award all benefit in life, is automatically obtained by the laws of nature, although it is a very rare achievement. You know how rare it is? How rare? There are 8.4 million species of life. 8.4 million. And in each of these species, now, the 400,000 are human species, and among them there are also demigods. Now in the races that we say, Chinese race or Indian race, or even in India there are many, many races, and you know, so many races, right? They actually, in Vedas, they are classified as species of human beings. So all these species of human beings are only 400,000. The 8 million are animals. Now in the 400,000 species, there is 7.7 billion population. But in the 8 million, oh, you take each species, they far outnumber. Each and every one of the species far outnumber, almost. I mean, not each and every species, but many species, especially the ones like ants, for example. You know how many trillions and trillions of ants on this earth? You can't even count. So those kinds of, and grass, say grass, how many grass are there? How many grasses? Each grass is a soul. No count. So the number of those species far outnumber the human population. And 7.7 billion is absolutely nothing compared to the numbers of these other species. That's just this earth. And now calculate the entire universe. Every single planet is full of life. So, we are very, 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 very small minority. It's very, very rare. So, what is so special about it? Okay. This human body can be compared to a perfectly constructed boat. The other are not perfectly constructed boat. Suppose you put some two woods, suppose you hold on to a plank of wood. That's not very, you know, it can, you know, keep you afloat for a while, but you know, you're going to drown soon. But if there is a nice big ship, of course, like the Titanic, it was a big ship, but it drowned. The mercy of the Lord should be there, of course. But generally, and especially when the mercy of the Lord is there, then that boat will never sink. So, the mercy of the Lord is there when we engage in devotional service. So here it is said, this human body can be compared to a perfectly constructed boat having the spiritual master as the captain and the instructions of the personality of Godhead as favorable winds impelling it on its course. Considering all these advantages, a human being who does not utilize his human life to cross the ocean of material existence must be considered the killer of his own soul. So, if there is a nice boat and if there is a nice captain, but if we don't take advantage of this and then jump into the water, it's absolute foolishness. It's absolutely suicidal. That's why he's Atmaha, killer of his own soul. Killer means, of course, the soul cannot be killed, but he's killing the natural constitutional position of the soul. And that means for a very, very long time, he's not going to return to this human life, which is the gateway back to his original constitutional position as a eternal servant of Krishna. So he's going to be there for a very, very long time in the animal species. And we have been through all these things. We have been through these things millions and millions of times. Not once, not twice. Millions of times. And how long do we want to continue these things? We should come out. Human body is meant for that. So this Jnana Plava, this boat of transcendental knowledge, what is it? We have seen briefly that Brahmeti Paramatmeti Bhagavanite Shabdate. And of all these, the Bhagavan, the boat of Bhagavan realization, that knowledge is the best. That is the strongest boat. And the spiritual master is the captain of that boat. All the other boats are only fake boats. The real rescue boat is the boat of devotion to the Lord. Because devotion to the Lord constitutes the highest knowledge, because it is on the Bhagavan platform. Devotion to the Lord is the highest education. One may be speculating and speculating and speculating, but until he comes to the point of Bhagavan realization, his realizations are not complete. You see? So, the boat of devotion is what we need to climb. That means we have to take to devotional service. And there are some nice verses in the Mukundamala Stotra. This is the 11th verse of the Mukundamala Stotra. Bhavajaladhigatanam dvandvavatahatanam Suta dohitra kalatra trana bhararditanam Vishama vishayatoye majjatama plavanam Bhavati sharanameko Vishnu poto naranam. Vishnu potaha. Plava means boat, potaha also means boat. Vishnu potaha. Vishnu poto naranam. The people in this vast ocean of birth and death are being blown about by the winds of material dualities. As they flounder in the perilous waters of sense indulgence with no boat to help them, they are sorely distressed by the need to protect their sons, daughters and wives. Only the boat that is Lord Vishnu can save them. Now, you are thrown into the sea, say, you have to save your own self. Added to that is the attachment that we have for our wife, our children, our relatives, our friends, and we are also worrying for their safety, how to save them. Worrying for our own safety is already a big thing, and added to that is the safety of, you know, worrying about the safety of the others, our so-called family members. That's why it is sorely distressed, you see. Sorely distressed with no boat to help them. Only the boat that is Lord Vishnu can save them. But this is only achieved by bhakti. Bhaktyamam abhijanati. The abhijanati. Actually, we should go to that verse first before this. The boat of knowledge, right, is non-different from the boat of devotion. That's what I'm trying to say. So, 11. First of all, we'll go to 1154 and then after that 1855. You see? 1154.
Bhaktya tvananya yashakya ahameva vidhorjuna jnatum drashtum cha tatvena praveshtum cha parantapa.
My dear Arjuna, only by undivided devotional service can I be understood as I am standing before you and can thus be seen directly. Only in this way can you enter into the mysteries of my understanding. You see, this is knowledge and it is only achieved by devotional service. So, when we say abode of knowledge, it is to be understood that it is the abode of devotion. Because without devotion, there is no knowledge. The Brahman realized people, they are only speculating. They are going on speculating. They don't have knowledge. They have partial knowledge. They know that this material world is not the right place. But they don't have the knowledge of what is the right place. They don't have information of the spiritual world. Same thing goes for the Paramatmavadis, the so-called yogis, who also end up in an impersonalistic understanding. Although they are supposed to realize the Paramatma, the super soul in the heart, they eventually end up wanting to merge into the form of the Lord rather than serve Him. So again the devotion is lost and again they will fall down. They climbed even higher and then they fall down. Aruhya kritcharena parampadam tataha patanti adhonadrita yushmadangrayaha. They haven't taken shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna. To take shelter of lotus feet of Krishna means, feet means who? Whose feet? A person's feet. So personal understanding is key for this. If I don't know that God is a person, then how can I hold on to His feet? A person has feet. How can an impersonal entity have feet? That's why it is said, the speculators, they can't even reach the toenails of the feet. Because feet means person. That's why it is said, you see.
Brahma Samhita 534.
Yeah, 534. You see this? Panthastu koti shatavat sarasam pragamyo vayo rathapi manaso munipungavanam sopyasti yat prapadasim nyavichintya tatve govindamadi purusham tamaham bhajami. Prapada means the feet. Prapada means just before the feet. What is it? The toenails. Now, I worship Govinda. Of course, here it is, the English of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur is way above our heads. But he's actually telling the same thing. I worship Govinda, the primeval Lord, only the tip of the toe of whose lotus feet is approached. Actually, not even approached. Just almost there, but not there yet. Is approached by the yogis who aspire after the transcendental and betake themselves to pranayama by drilling the respiration, or by the jnanis who try to find out the non-differentiated Brahman by the process of elimination of the mundane, extending over thousands of millions of years. This is the result of the speculators. So they are not on the jnana plava. Nobody is on the jnana plava except the devotee. If we think jnana is something else than devotion, that is our misconception. Let's go there. To Srimad Bhagavatam, 2nd Canto, 9th chapter, verse number 34, Lord Vishnu says to Brahma, Ritirtham yat pratiyeta na pratiyeta chatmani tad vidyadatmano mayam yatha abhaso yatha tamaha. O Brahma, whatever appears to be of any value, if it is without relation to me, has no reality. Know it as my illusory energy, that reflection which appears to be in darkness. See this? If it is anything unrelated to the form of Krishna, that is illusion, that is not knowledge. So everything other than the personal understanding of the Lord is actual knowledge. I'm sorry, because there is a kind of bee here which is coming onto the camera lens. Because we are talking about the honey topics of the Lord, so this bee has come now. I don't know where the bee came from. So, you see, so this is the thing, yatha bhaso yatha tamaha. So that is abhasa, that is reflection, that's not the truth, that is seeming truth but not truth. So we have to be really firm in the understanding that when we say boat of knowledge, it is boat of devotion. Okay, another verse about knowledge, we'll go to this verse 15:19. यो मामेवम सम्मूढो जानाति पुरुषोत्तमं ससर्वविद् भजति मां सर्वभावेन भारत. Whoever knows me as the Supreme Personality of Godhead without doubting is the knower of everything. He has actual knowledge of everything. He therefore engages himself in full devotional service to me, O son of Bharata. And another place also it is said, so chapter 7, text 19. What is that? Famous verse. Bahunam janmanamante jnanavan mam prapadyate vasudeva sarvamiti sa mahatma sudurlabha. After many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders unto me. Knowing me to be the cause of all causes and all that is, such a great soul is very rare. This is the person who is actually in knowledge. What about the others? They think they are in knowledge. Avishuddha buddhayaha vimukta maninas. Vimukta manina means they think they are already liberated with knowledge, but no, they don't have. So jnana plavenaiva means by devotion. So to engage in devotional service is the summum bonum of all knowledge. Let's go back to the Mukundamala Stotra verses. There are more verses in the Mukundamala Stotra there. This is the 11th verse. Let's go to the 12th verse.
Bhavajaladhim agadham dustaram nistareyam kathamahamiti cheto masmagaha kataratvam sarasija drishideve तारकी भक्ति रेका नरक अभिधि निषण्णा तारयिष्यत्यवश्यम्.
वेरी ब्यूटिफुल वर्स. यू सी, डियर माइंड, डू नॉट बिवल्डर योरसेल्फ बाय एंग्शियसली थिंकिंग हाउ कैन आई क्रॉस दिस फैथमलेस एंड इम्पॉसिबल ओशन ऑफ मेटीरियल एग्जिस्टेंस. देर इज वन हू कैन सेव यू, डिवोशन. If you offer her to the lotus-eyed Lord, the killer of Narakasura, she will carry you across this ocean without fail. This is the boat of devotion. Actually, there is another verse here, wait. Yeah, I think 13, next verse. Yes, bhaktinavam. 13th verse. There's a B, so I'm sorry.
Trishnato ye madana pavano dhuta mohor mimale daravarte tanayasahaja graha sangha kulecha. Samsarakhe mahati jaladhau majjatam nastridhaman padam bhoje varada bhavato bhakti navam prayacha.
This is a beautiful verse. You see, trishna to ye, trishna means thirst, suffering. Now, ओ लॉर्ड ऑफ द थ्री वर्ल्ड्स वी आर ड्राउनिंग इन द वास्ट ओशन ऑफ संसार विच इज फिल्ड विद द वाटर्स ऑफ मटेरियल हैंकरिंग विद मेनी वेव्स ऑफ इल्यूजन व्हिप्ड अप बाय द विंड्स ऑफ लस्ट विद वर्लपूल्स ऑफ वाइव्स एंड विद वास्ट स्कूल्स ऑफ शार्क्स एंड अदर सी मॉन्स्टर्स हु आर आवर सन्स एंड ब्रदर्स ओ गिवर ऑफ ऑल बेनेडिक्शंस प्लीज ग्रांट मी अ प्लेस ऑन द बोट ऑफ डिवोशन दैट इज योर लोटस फीट. To maintain all these sharks and everything, which are our family members, we have to take to means of livelihood which are very dangerous and involving so many sinful activities. That was the case of Valmiki, for example, and Ajamil. They were examples of this. To maintain their families, they did so many sinful activities. And don't think that we are excluded from this. Let me give you an example. The person who is earning the livelihood for his family by driving the McDonald's delivery bike, sinful, because he's delivering all the meat. The one who is the bartender at the pub, he's sinful. He's, you know, intoxicating and spreading intoxication to others. Illicit sex, gambling, these things are going on. And not that we are immune to all these things. We are directly or indirectly assisting all these things. We all are facilitating these things. Why? For example, how, one is a software coder. I have many times told this. So he may be writing a software, coding a software for a bank, and that bank is holding accounts for McDonald's, for KFC, for hotel, for this and that, so many sinful businesses, slaughterhouse, I mean, so many. So, and I am facilitating the bank to everything, you know, put security, securely hold the funds of this, this meat eating company or meat company or whatever, you see, and not just one company, how many thousands and millions, and I am supporting, you see. So, I am directly or indirectly supporting the sinful activities. Okay, let's take another example. Suppose a doctor, he is saving lives, noble work, right? What if, any person who is a meat eater, for example, so this person saves his life, his duty, he has to save life. Then he goes on doing more meat eating, facilitated. Or maybe this person is a CEO of a meat company, and he went into the hospital, and this doctor did some nice surgery, and he got himself on his feet, and then again he pushed his business even more, and more meat got sold. Prabhupada said, you know that incident I told many times, I don't know if you remember. So Prabhupada was in this car and the devotee was driving it, and you know, and there are three or four lanes or whatever on the highway. So there was another car going in the adjacent lane. Now behind that car was a frozen meat truck. Now he honked, peep peep. Then the car in the front, he moved aside, or he moved in here. So, and then the meat truck went faster. Prabhupada said, this car driver who has given the way for the meat truck, he is also implicated in that killing of all the animals that are in that meat truck. So don't think, no, I'm just doing my duty, I'm just a doctor, or I'm just a clerk, or I'm just a coder, I'm a software engineer, I'm a hardware engineer. It's all going in the same direction. Everybody is sinfully implicated. Suppose somebody is a marine engineer. He's building ships, and the ships are carrying full of beer, meat, condoms, I mean, just is everywhere. Sinful activities everywhere, all pervading. Kali has taken over everything in this world, in this Kali Yuga. So we are intentionally or unintentionally supporting. For what? Why are we supporting? To maintain our families. Vast schools of sharks and other sea monsters who are our sons and brothers. Why they are called sea monsters? Why? No, my brother and sister very, very nice. You know, they're very, very, very friendly, very nice. They're not like the sharks, you know. Yeah. But it's an illusion, because for these family members, I have to work hard, and I am being robbed of my chance to go back to Godhead. Instead, I am being pulled down. You say, Dharavarte, the whirlpools of wives. The wife is like a whirlpool, suck us even deeper into the ocean. Because it is because of the wife. Maybe the wife will, even if the wife is absolutely chaste and absolutely, it's good if it is like that. But, if she's a devotee, that's a different thing. But if, you know, she's not a devotee especially, or even a half-baked devotee and not interested really, you know. So, it's a mess. And it just pulled us down into this material ocean. So, and not just by her, but because I have a wife, now I have to work to maintain all this, you know, my home, children, relatives, wealth, and I have to support some sinful activity. Valmiki and Ajamil, they did directly, we are doing indirectly. So, same thing. So, to maintain our family. So, in the name of a wife, or in the name of children, what are they doing? They are forcing us to do sinful activities. This is why they are enemies. Of course, if it is a devotee, that's a different issue. But otherwise, it's all anyway. So, the boat of devotion is the only way. Bhakti navam prayachha. This is bhakti navam, or jnana plave, plane, what? Plavena iva, plavena, jnana plava, jnana plava. So another verse is there. And Srimad Bhagavatam 10:14:58. Samashritaye padapallava plavam mahatpadam punyayashomurare Bhavambudhirvatsa padam param padam 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 yadvipadam natesham. You see this. For those who have accepted the boat of the lotus feet of the Lord, who is the shelter of the cosmic manifestation and is famous as Murari, the enemy of the Mura demon, the ocean of material world is like the water contained in a calf's hoofprint. Their goal is Parampadam Vaikuntha, the place where there are no material miseries, not the place where there is danger at every step. Now, how big is the boat? Now, a very big ship, even the Titanic ship, was like just like a matchstick on the ocean, right? How big is the boat of Lord Vishnu, or the devotion to him? How big can it be? And why won't it sink like the Titanic? Because it's bigger than the ocean. It's bigger than the ocean, so much so that the ocean itself becomes like a water contained in a calf's hoof print. That big. So it's no more a boat, it's a bridge. It's just a bridge. Easy bridge. What is that verse? Padma Puran. Tamadidevam karunanidhanam tamalavarnam suhitavataram aparasamsara samudra setum bhajamahe bhagavata swarupam. This insurmountable, impassable ocean of material existence, we can pass by this bridge of the Bhagavatam. And how long we have to walk on this Bhagavatam bridge? How long is the bridge? Well, the water in the ocean becomes like a water in a calf's hoof print. If we, of course, really take to the Bhagavatam, that means we have to absolutely surrender to the message of the Bhagavatam and live by the Bhagavatam. Then yes, the whole ocean becomes like a small puddle of water. Easily you can jump over 10 such puddles. I think one of the videos I have said, वी कैन जंप ओवर 10 भवसागर्स, 10 ओशंस ऑफ मेटीरियल एग्जिस्टेंस इजिली, लाइक चाइल्ड्स प्ले. सो दैट इज द काइंड ऑफ बोट. सो दिस इज हाउ वी हैव टू टेक शेल्टर ऑफ कृष्ण. एंड टेकिंग शेल्टर ऑफ कृष्ण मीन्स वॉट? How am I going to sit on this boat? Where is the boat? How can I see this boat? The boat is the Sankirtan movement, the holy name of Krishna and the Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. This Shravanam Kirtanam, this Sankirtan movement is Shravanam Kirtanam. So this we have to do. And that is the meaning of taking shelter at the lotus feet. That's why we have to hear, even if he is the most sinful, if he takes to the transcendental knowledge, then he will be santarishyasi. You know the word, today's verse? See, santarishyasi vrijinam santarishyasi. Tarishyasi means to cross. Santarishasi means completely cross. Like tosha means happy, pleased. Santosha means completely pleased. So purna means complete. Sampurna means absolutely complete, perfectly complete. So when the prefix sam is used, and that means completely. Santarishasi. Completely we will be able to cross. Now our position is, what is that? Samyak, what is that? Mukundamala Stotra, 16th verse. He martyaha paramam hitam shrunutavo वक्ष्यामि संक्षेपता संसारार्णवमापदूर्मि बहुलं सम्यक् प्रविश्य स्थिताः. सम्यक्, व्हाट इज सम्यक्? फुल्ली प्रविश्य स्थितः. वी विल सी. हे मर्त्याः परमं हितं शृणु तवो वक्ष्यामि संक्षेपताः संसारार्णवमापदूर्मि बहुलं सम्यक् प्रविश्य स्थिताः नानाज्ञानमपास्य चेतसि नमो नारायणायेत्यमुं मन्त्रं सप्रणवं प्रणामसहितं प्रावर्तयध्वं मुहुः. यू सी, here's a very interesting verse. O mortal beings, you have submerged yourself. Samyak pravashyata, pravishyasthitaha. Samyak pravashya means completely immersed deep into the waters of the ocean. You have submerged deep into the waters of the ocean. You're not just on the surface, you're way deep. You have submerged yourselves fully in the ocean of material existence, which is filled with the waves of misfortune. Please hear as I briefly tell you how to attain your supreme benefit. Just put aside your various attempts at gaining knowledge and instead begin constantly chanting the mantra Om Namo Narayanaya and bowing down to the Lord. Here is saying something else. In the Bhagavad Gita, today's verse, Jnana Plavenaiva. Once one gets onto the boat of transcendental knowledge, he crosses. Here he is saying, put aside all your various attempts at gaining knowledge. What is this? This is the knowledge that is speculative knowledge. Gaining knowledge means gaining with our own senses. Whereas transcendental knowledge means revealed knowledge. We are not gaining with our exercise of our senses. No. Revealed to us by the pleasure of the Lord. When the Lord is pleased, how is He pleased? By our devotional service. So when we execute devotional service, the Lord becomes pleased with us. Dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayantite. But who? तेषां सततयुक्तानां भजतां प्रीतिपूर्वकं. दोज हु आर एंगेज इन हिज डिवोशनल सर्विस विथ लव एंड डिवोशन, टू देम ही गिव्स द इंटेलिजेंस, टू देम ही गिव्स द नॉलेज. मत्त स्मृति ज्ञानम अपोहनम च. एंड फॉर दोज हु आर नॉट इंटरेस्टेड इन हिज डिवोशन, अपोहनम, दे फॉरगेट एवरीथिंग अबाउट देयर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल पोजिशन एंड दे एक्ट लाइक फूल्स. So he's saying, put aside all your things, just chant Om Namo Narayana. In our case, Hare Krishna. So the Hare Krishna Mahamantra we have to chant, because Vidya Vadhu Jivanam, it is the condensed knowledge of the entire Vedas. Iti Shodasakam Namnam Kalikalma Sunasanam Natah Parataropaya Sarvavede Shudrishyate. There is no other better way, after studying the entire Vedic literature, there is no other better way than the chanting of Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. It's the best. Vidyavadhu Jivanam Anandam Budhi Vardhanam Pratipadam Purnamrita Swadhanam Sarvatma Snapanam Param Vijayate Shri Krishna Sankirtanam. So, the Sankirtan movement is full of knowledge, is the concentrated knowledge. So, don't think that when you are doing service to Krishna, you are bereft of knowledge. If we are actually bereft of knowledge, if we are just doing it with our body and not involving our mayarpita manobuddhi, if we don't involve our mind and intelligence into it, you know, we may lose track, we may give up the path because of our foolishness. Of course, even if we give up, there is no loss. Krishna will, you know, save us back. There are so many verses supporting that. But why should we give trouble to Krishna to save us every time that we fall? No. A devotee means he will not want to give any trouble to Krishna. Not even to keep on, you know, saving him from all kinds of fall downs. No. A devotee is not attention seeking, but he invariably draws the attention of the Lord. That's another thing. But he is not attention seeking. He just goes about doing his service. When we fall down, yes, the Lord will definitely show his attention. That's his causeless mercy. But the devotee is not doing this as a tantrum. If he does something like that, oh, let me fall down and let the Lord come and pick me up. What? The Krishna won't fall for our tantrums, you know. If we by chance, you know, because of force of our previous habits, we fall down, that's another thing. But if we try to test Krishna, oh, I'm seriously chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna is not coming. No, I will fall down for a while. You know, then Krishna will come and save me. Naham prakasa sarvasa apohanam cha. I'll let you go. You go and fully test. You are not interested in me, right? You are just interested in your own tantrums, and then once I show myself to you, you will proclaim everywhere. Or, no, you just understand your lesson. So Krishna will not, Krishna has the right to reserve showing himself from anyone. So he only shows himself to that person who is premanjana churita bhakti vilochanena, who is imbued with devotion. Again, it comes back to the same thing, devotion. Bhaktyaham ekaya grahyaham. Bhaktyaham ekaya grahyaham. श्रद्धयात्मा प्रियः सतां भक्तिः पुनाति मन्निष्ठा श्वपाकान् अपि संभवात्. Only by practicing unalloyed devotional service with full faith in me can one obtain me, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I am naturally dear to my devotees who take me as the only goal of their loving service. By engaging in such pure devotional service, even the dog eaters can purify themselves from the contamination of their low birth. Dog eaters, this is what is that? Sarvebhya papakrit tamaha. The worst of sinners. Apichetasi papebhyas sarvebhya papakrittamaha. What is that? ज्ञान प्लवेन एव व्हाट इज द फर्स्ट वर्ड ऑफ द थर्ड लाइन वृजनम संतरिष्यसि सर्वम सर्वम ज्ञान प्लवेन एव वृजनम संतरिष्यसि इवन द वर्स्ट सिनर यू सी हियर स्वपाकानपि संभवात Even dog eaters can purify themselves from the contamination of their low birth. And that is explained by Devahuti also said that. 333, 7. Actually, let's go to 6 and 7.
Yannamadheya shravananukirtanad यत् प्रह्मणाद् यत् स्मरणाद् अपि क्वचित् श्वादोपि सद्यः सवनाय कल्पते कुतः पुनस्ते भगवन्नु दर्शनात्
टू से नथिंग ऑफ द स्पिरिचुअल एडवांसमेंट ऑफ पर्सन्स हु सी द सुप्रीम पर्सन फेस टू फेस इवन अ पर्सन बोर्न इन अ फैमिली ऑफ डॉग ईटर्स इमीडिएटली बिकम्स एलिजिबल टू परफॉर्म वेदिक सैक्रिफाइसेस इफ ही वंस अटर्स द होली नेम of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, or chants about Him, hears about His pastimes, offers Him obeisances, or even remembers Him. Next.
Aho batashvapachoto gariyan yajjih vagre vartate namatubhyam te pustapaste juhuvuhu sasnurarya brahmanu chur namagrinanti yete
Shvapacho. Oh, how glorious are they whose tongues are chanting your holy name. Even if born in the families of dog eaters, such persons are worshipable. Persons who chant the holy name of your lordship must have executed all kinds of austerities and fire sacrifices and achieved all the good manners of the Aryans. To be chanting the holy name of your lordship, they must have bathed at holy places of pilgrimage, studied the Vedas, and fulfilled everything required. You see? They must have bathed their holy places, studied the Vedas. You see, all knowledge is there for one who is chanting. Even if he is born in a dog eater family, if he is chanting now, that means he is deemed to have understood all the Vedas. But if one is big, big mantra tantra visharadaha, avaishnava guru nasyat, Vaishnava swapacho guru. One may be a big visharad. Visharad means expert in chanting all the mantras, shlokas. But if he is not a Vaishnav, then he is worse than a so-called dog eater from a dog eating family, and that person is better. That is also explained in the 7, 9, 10 by Prahlad Maharaj. Beautiful verse.
Vipra-dvishad-guna-yutad-aravindanabha पादारविंद विमुखात् श्वपचं वरिष्ठं मन्ये तदर्पित मनो वचने हितार्थ प्राणं पुनाति सकुलं न तु भूरिमानः विप्राद्विषड्गुणयुताद् अरविंदनाभ पादारविंद विमुखात् श्वपचं वरिष्ठं
यू सी इफ अ ब्राह्मण हैज All 12 of the Brahminical qualifications as they are stated in the book called Sanat Sujata, but is not a devotee and is averse to the lotus feet of the Lord, he is certainly lower than a devotee who is a dog eater but who has dedicated everything, mind, words, activities, wealth and life to the Supreme Lord. Such a devotee is better than such a Brahmana because the devotee can purify his whole family. Whereas a so-called Brahmana in a position of false prestige cannot purify even himself. And these are the 12 qualifications of a Brahmana in the Sanat Sujata book.
Jnanam cha satyam cha damah shrutam cha hyamatsariyam hristitikshanu suya yajnyascha danam cha dhritihi samascha mahavrata dvadasha brahmanasya.
So these are the 12 qualifications of Brahmana. But if he has all these things, so-called Jnanam, if he has Jnanam, Jnanaplava, what happened? So this Jnanam is, as long as it is devoid of Vaishnava, I mean, devotional service, that's not full knowledge. That's imperfect knowledge. If he is actually in knowledge, Bahunam Janmanamante Gyanavan Mam Prapadyate, he will surrender to Krishna. But if he does not surrender, what knowledge does he have? It's just an illusory knowledge. So Jnanam cha Satyam cha Tamas Shrutam cha, he is, you know, vastly read. Like Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was a perfect example. Before he became a devotee, he was Mantra Tantra Visharada. Sarvabhauma, what is the meaning of Sarvabhauma? Bhumi means the earth. Bhauma means of everyone on the earth. Sarvabhauma means of all persons, all the people on the earth. Sarvabhauma. Sarvabhauma means who has conquered all the people of the earth. That means there is nobody equal to Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya in scholarship. He was actually incarnation of Brihaspati, the celestial priest. Who can equal him in knowledge? But he was a non-devotee before he met Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And despite his vast knowledge, he is humble, yes, to an extent. But pride is also there. Of course, pride will be there. Unless one is a devotee, he will be proud. So, he has, yes, all the Brahmins. In fact, sannyasis were his disciples. He was a grihastha. But sannyasis used to study under him. That was Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. But he was a non-devotee. Of course, by the grace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his brother-in-law Gopinath Acharya, he became a devotee. Very, very exalted devotee. But you see, that is the point. If he is non-devotee, useless. Whatever jnanam he has, will bear no fruit. It's just a waste of time, beating an empty husk. These are all the verses, examples given in the Srimad Bhagavatam. So, take to this Krishna consciousness very seriously. The knowledge is there. The activity based on the knowledge is there. That means practical application of the knowledge. So, everything is there. Just we have to plug into that. That's it. The system is all there. Just like, you know, for our lights and all this, in internet and everything, we need electricity. Now, electricity, for us to go and, you know, harvest electricity, that's beyond our capacity. But powerhouse is there, and then the power is routed all the way, you know, to all the way until our wall. And now, to access the electricity, I just have to plug inside. That's it. It has come until here. So similarly, the electricity, electrical arrangement, that means the connection with the Supreme Lord has been all the way now on our wall. I mean, literally. We have to plug into it. That's it. That means, in other words, we have to just follow this process. The process is all there. Just we need to plug ourselves into the process. It doesn't matter whatever sin we have done, whatever anything we have done. Everything will be taken care of. Sarva papebhyo moksha ishyami. Krishna is assuring. We have to have the confidence. Goptritve varnam tatha. Goptritve varnam tatha. That means we have to have the faith that Krishna will rakshishyati iti vishvaso. Krishna will protect us. He is our guardian. So that is surrender. So our movement is for that, this Krishna consciousness movement. So take it seriously by chanting, hearing, and that's it. Even if one is not so scholarly, you see. Chapter 13, verse 26. Anyetvevam ajanantah shrutvanyebhya upasate tepi chati tarantyeva mrityum shrutiparayanah. Cha atitaranti. Taranti means tarishyasi, santarishyasi. You see the, you should see all these connections. Cha atitaranti, transcend, cross. Atitaranti. So here it is said, 13.26 of Bhagavad Gita. Again, there are those who, although not conversant with in spiritual knowledge, begin to worship the Supreme Person upon hearing about Him from others. They may not be very conversant, but they hear about Krishna from others, from realized devotees, and they also begin worshipping the Supreme Lord. Because of their tendency to hear from authorities, they also transcend the path of birth and death. Santarishyasi. by just by this process of hearing is a very powerful process. Tasmat sankirtanam vishnor jagan mangalam amhasam mahatam api kauravya vidhyaikantika nishkritam. So this is the most auspicious activity in the entire universe. This we have to be absolutely convinced what we are doing here is the most auspicious activity in the entire universe. Nothing is as pure as what we are doing. Everyone will think like that, of course. But our thinking is backed by what Krishna is saying in the Shastra, whereas others' thinking is not based on Shastra. That's the difference. Yes, everybody has have their own, everybody thinks their path is the best. Well, they may think, but only what Krishna thinks matters. So his opinion is fact. Our opinion may or may not be fact. If it coincides with Krishna's opinion, yes, it's fact. If it does not coincide, then it's not a fact. It's our own imagination. And it's just illusion. It's just like a dream. No point dwelling on it. So we have to always take guidance from Krishna and execute on it. That's it. Alright, I will stop here. So any questions or comments? Let me see. Definitely there are some questions I saw. Wow, so many questions. Okay. Question 1 by Bhakta Virendra. What is the meaning of Shri Guru Karuna Sindhu Adhama Janarabandhu? Does the saint or one spiritual master pardon us from our sins? Well, the meaning is that he has given us the path how to cross this ocean of material existence. That's why his Karuna Sindhu Adhama Janarabandhu. Pardon you from sins? Pardon us from sins? Well, he will to an extent, but if we take advantage of that, he is not obliged anymore. He is not obliged. We can't take, like, you know, take him for granted, you know, just like the Christians, many Christians, they do like that. They confess every Sunday and then Monday they come back, do the same nonsense, and again Sunday they confess, they think Jesus to be a joke. You dump all the, he's a rubbish man, you know, dump all the rubbish sin on him and then come and come, now I'm fresh, now let me sin in the whole week and Sunday I'll come back and again confess and dump all the sin again on Jesus and he will continue to be hanged on the cross for me. What is this? So that is not disciple. Disciple means he should not give any trouble to the spiritual master or Krishna. That is disciple. So, Guru is Karuna Sindhu, but you know, we have to be also sincere disciples. Otherwise, it will not bear effect, you know. Guru can be perfect, but if we are not perfect, then what is the point? Same thing. If you sow seeds on a barren land, it won't sprout. So, if we have to not remain as barren land, it will be fertile. For that, we have to do, what is that? Pranipatena, Pariprashnena and Sevaya. Three things. Surrender, submissive inquiry and service. With full attention, with full involvement. One may, for time being, he may be influenced by sinful activity because of past habit, but you know, he should come back and rectify himself and engage in himself again in devotional service. Next question by Bhaktin Pooja. In Jain community, they always serve spiritual master and chant their spiritual master and serve them only in name. Are they able to go back to Godhead? When in Jain, well, in Jain religion, there is no conception of a personality of Godhead. So, if we don't have a personality of Godhead, we can never enter into the kingdom of God. Never. So, you have to know that he is a person. Then only one is eligible to enter into the kingdom of God. Next question by Bhaktin Pooja again. What is the peculiar age for taking spiritual knowledge? Particular age. Okay. What is the particular age for taking spiritual knowledge? What is the minimum age? Well, what is the minimum age for material knowledge? When do you start? Or material schooling, when does it start? There is the primary school, but before that there is a kindergarten, which is the preparation for the actual school. And now there is preparation for the preparation of the school, which is preschool, they say, you know. So they are starting at 2-3 years old already, they are starting play school, preschool or whatever they call it. So that should be the same thing for spiritual knowledge. In fact, even before that, way before that, before even conception, the mother and father should be Krishna conscious. And even while pregnant, the mother has to be Krishna conscious, the father also has to be Krishna conscious. And then they're just like Prahlad Maharaj.
I didn't understand that.
Because he's a fool, he cannot understand these things. That was the... this is too high subject matter for this fool. So, yeah. So, from the womb of the mother. Prahlad Maharaj's education started from the womb of his mother. That should be the case. So, the material schools are starting at 2 years old. Our school should start before 0 years old. minus 9 months old. You should already start. And then throughout the pregnancy of his mother, Prahlad Maharaj was hearing from Narad Muni, from the womb. And then he became a great devotee when he came out. So this is the way, it's a whole science. Family planning means not using condom. That's not family plan. Family planning means beget children and make them Krishna conscious. Make plans how to make them Krishna conscious. That is the family planning. Not how to abort. In fact, Sundagopal Prabhu actually showed one purport. Bhruna. Okay, let me take that out. I think I remember the word. Here it is. You see, this is today's education. So called Jnana Plava. Actually, Ashma Plava is a stone boat. What is this? Tasya Sadhora Papasya Bhrunasya Brahmavadinaha. Katham Vadham Yatha Babhror Manyate Sanmato Bhavan. You are well known and worshipped in learned circles. How dare you kill this Brahmana, who is a saintly, sinless person, well versed in Vedic knowledge? Killing him would be like destroying the embryo within the womb or killing a cow. That means, in other words, killing a Brahmana, killing a cow, and killing the embryo within the womb are very, very, very sinful activities. And today's family planning is about this. This is today's family planning. How to destroy the embryo within the womb. You see, as stated in the Amarakosha dictionary, Brunor Bhake Balagarbhe. Amarakosha dictionary. The word Bruna refers either to the cow or to the living entity in embryo. According to Vedic culture, destroying the undeveloped embryo of the soul in the womb is as sinful as killing a cow or a Brahmana. In the embryo, the living entity is present in an undeveloped stage. The modern scientific theory that life is a combination of chemicals is nonsense. Why Srila Prabhupada combated this, life comes from chemicals? Because the thing is just chemicals inside, just you kill, not a big deal, it's just chemicals. So they're just fooling everybody and then throwing them into hell. So he wants to save them. So that's why he wanted to challenge this whole nonsense theory that life comes from chemicals. Or some amino acids and some what is it? All kinds of, you know, chemicals come together and that's life. Organic chemicals, they say. Organic chemicals. There's no such thing. All chemicals, none of them can produce life. In fact, from life comes chemicals. Not from chemicals comes life. So the modern scientific theory that life is a combination of chemicals is nonsense. Scientists cannot manufacture living beings, even like those born from eggs. The idea that scientists can develop a chemical situation resembling that of an egg and bring life from it is nonsensical. And they have test tube baby and all these things, but what is it? It is just a cheap imitation of a real test tube which is already there, the womb. Their theory that a chemical combination can have life may be accepted, but these rascals cannot create such a combination. Okay? Even accepting your combination, okay, from chemicals come from life, okay, never mind, we accept. Show? They cannot show. Where is the basis? There is no basis in fact. This verse refers to Bhrunasya Vadham, the killing of a Bhruna or destruction of the embryo. Here is a challenge from the Vedic literature. The crude atheistic understanding that the living entity is a combination of matter belongs to the grossest ignorance. If the embryo is not a living thing, it's just the chemicals, the word killing would not be applicable to the word bhruna. Bhrunasya vadham. So, this is the thing. Ashwathama wanted to kill the embryo of Parikshit. What happened to him? He remained as a ghost. He is still remaining as a ghost. And he will remain as a ghost until the end of Kali Yuga, until the end of this Manu. And after that, he will become one of the Saptarishis. Of course. That's another thing. He is a great personality. I mean, he was there when Krishna was there. No, it's not ordinary. But to show, he did so much sinful activity. He killed them in the night, the Pandava's sons. And then he tried to kill the womb. Bhruna Garbha Vadham. Bhruna Garbhavadham or Bhrunavadham. So this so-called abortion, this kind of family planning is useless. We will remain as a ghost, whoever does this. And the mother, that mother will not see daylight. Womb after womb after womb after womb, she will just go into dark, dark. She will never see light of day. But if you come to the transcendental knowledge, bhakti path, then yes, even the worst sin is forgiven, provided you don't repeat again, provided the person doesn't repeat again. So it is very powerful, this bhakti path, but we cannot take advantage and do it again. See? So what is the minimum age in short? Minus 9 months. That is the minimum age. Well, of course, there is this verse, Kaumara Acharit Pragyam 761. Shri Prahladu Vacha. Kaumara Acharit Pragyo Dharman Bhagavataniha Durlabham Manusham Janma Tadapyadhruvamarthadam. Prahlad Maharaj said, one who is sufficiently intelligent should use the human form of body from the very beginning of life. In other words, from the tender age of childhood. Kaumara means very, very small. Kumar. Of course, it says 5 years old, but even before that, one can start. We have children who are like 4 or 5 years old, they are chanting nicely shlokas. How? Because they are just hearing. So, even before 5 years old, yes, they can do. Even we see Narayani, 2 years, not even 3 years old yet. She is chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So, that's how we should be. How they will chant? Unless they hear these things, they won't chant. So, of course, there are many other devotees' children also, they are nicely chanting. So, this is because they are hearing. Should use the human form of body from the very beginning of life. In other words, from the tender age of childhood, to practice the activities of devotional service, giving up all other engagements. The human body is most rarely achieved, and although temporary like other bodies, it is meaningful because in human life one can perform devotional service. Even a slight amount of sincere devotional service can give one complete perfection. So from childhood we must start. Next question by Bhakta Virendra. What about the species that are getting endangered or are extinct? There is no such thing as extinct or endangered. They may be not visible on this planet, but other planets there are. No, nothing is extinct. We may not see. That is our own limited view. For example, in my room, there may be no cockroach. That does not mean there is no more cockroach in the whole world. No. So, similarly, our planet is like one small room in the whole universe. If we hear one animal is missing, it's not that nowhere in the universe in the whole this animal is existing. No. So, it's foolishness. Anyway, that so-called wiping them out from the surface of this planet is also done by stupid humans. The worst pandemic is the human pandemic. Not the virus, the COVID-19, this is all very lightweight. In fact, it is very beneficial. Animals are enjoying it, COVID-19. The human pandemic is the worst thing. Just destroy every single thing. If it was not human, the extent of damage that the human species has done in the last 100 or 200 years to the world, If any other organism does this and we are watching that, we will be horrified. We will quickly take that down. I mean, even coronavirus, which is far, far, I mean, thousands and millions of times less dangerous than humans. We're already like whole world is paralyzed and everything. What if an organism is so powerful that they can do as much damage as we humans are doing? We will immediately wipe them out or try to wipe them out. So actually human race deserves to be wiped out actually. That is the kind of people there are now. They don't deserve to live. So therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did not kill because they are already as good as dead. They don't deserve to live at all. Already their lives are like as good as dead. What is the use of killing them? So give them Harinam. So then they can come out. Next question by Vijay Sharma Prabhu. What about the trillions of microbes in each living and non-living body? Well, what about them? Yeah. Everything, so many, all of them are living entities. So just see how rare our human body is. The number of organisms within our body is more than the entire human population on the earth. In our single body, the number of microorganisms that are there is more than the human population on the earth. That's how rare we are. And if we just lose this chance, living just like the virus or the animal, cat, dog, it's absolute foolishness. We have to quickly get onto the Jnana Plava, the boat of transcendental knowledge. That is our Krishna consciousness movement. Next question by Bhakta Virendra. Do animals exist in spiritual world? So are those animals spiritually elevated and will not fall down? Yeah, there are animals in the spiritual world. There are birds, there are everything. Where is that? Plants, everything is there. They are all fully self-realized souls. Three, 15, 18 probably. Yeah.
पारावतान्यभृतसारसचक्रवाकदात्यूहहंसशुकतित्तिरिबर्हिणां यः कोलाहलो विरमते चिरमात्रमुच्चैर्भृङ्गाधिपे हरिकथां इव गायमाने.
When the king of bees hums in a high pitch, singing the glories of the Lord, there is a temporary lull in the noise of the pigeon, the cuckoo, the crane, the chakravaka, the swan, the parrot, the partridge, and the peacock. Such transcendental birds stop their own singing simply to hear the glories of the Lord from the bee. So even the bees are, you know, full of, what is that?
Chintamani prakara sadma sukalpa vriksha lakshavriteshu surabhira bhipalayantam.
There are so many cows there. So there are all kinds of animals there in the spiritual world, but they're all self-realized souls. Unless there are animals in the spiritual world, how there are animals in the material world? Everything here has its source in the spiritual world.
Janmadhyasya yataha aham sarvasya prabhavo.
He is the origin of everything. So he must also be having those things. Next question by Bhaktin Puja. In the spiritual world, virus, bacteria or vrion, prion and other creature like 8.6 million species exist or not?
Yes.
A transcendental virus. They infect the devotees with Krishna consciousness. They infect the devotee with madness of love for Krishna. That's why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, what he says, Ainanda Tanuja Kinkaram Patitam Mam Vishame Bhavam Budho Kripayatava Pada Pankaja Stita Dhuli Sadrisham Vichintaya. Let me become a particle of dust at your lotus feet, Krishna. Particle of dust, that is like a microbe. Let me just become a microbe at your feet. See? So that is the prayer of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, this is a transcendental virus. नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन व्हाट इज दिस तेषाम अहम समुद्धर्ता मृत्यु संसार सागरात् भवामि नचिरात् पार्थ मय्यावेशित चेतसाम रेफरेंस फ्रॉम भक्त वीरेंद्र या यस दैट इज वेरी गुड वर्स बिकॉज ही टेक अस टू द अदर साइड वेरी गुड रेफरेंस भगवद गीता चैप्टर 12 6 and 7. You see this one, 12.7. Tesham aham samuddharta mrityu samsara sagarat bhavamina chirat partha maya veshat chetasam. So, but those who worship me, giving up all their activities unto me and being devoted to me without deviation, engaged in devotional service and always meditating upon me, having fixed their minds upon me, O son of Pritha. For them, I am the swift deliverer from the ocean of birth and death. Santarishyasi. Very good. Very nice reference. So, he will take us to the other side of the ocean of birth and death. Next, Bhaktin Puja. How we can achieve real knowledge? I mean, how we got excellency in real knowledge? Just for mankind. Go to the guru who has the knowledge. Tattva Darshina. That is the verse 434. तद्विद्धि प्रणिपातेन परिप्रश्नेन सेवया उपदेक्षन्ति ते ज्ञानं ज्ञानिनः तत्त्वदर्शिनः 4.34 of Bhagavad Gita. Just try to learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master. Inquire from him submissively and render service unto him. The self-realized souls can impart knowledge unto you because they have seen the truth. So, we have to go to the Sadguru. Not that Sadguru who is Asadguru. Real Sadguru, who is actually a Acharya, who is devotee of Krishna, pure devotee, like Srila Prabhupada. So, how we can achieve real knowledge? We have to go to the real Guru, Srila Prabhupada. We don't have to search out now who is the real Guru. Prabhupada is already there. So, his books are there. Read his books. And associate with devotees who are pushing on his movement, who are working under his direction. That's how we'll get real knowledge. By associating with those people who have real knowledge. Just like how we will have material knowledge, by going to the university and associating with the professors there, then we get the knowledge, material knowledge. By associating with those people who have the knowledge. Similarly, we have to go to the professor of the spiritual knowledge. That is the guru. Next question by Bhakta Virendra. Are there any ascending stages in bhakti which progresses from karma bhakti to jnana bhakti to highest prema bhakti? Yeah, that is karma yoga, jnana yoga. So, as long as we are not in pure bhakti yoga, then we can dovetail whatever we are doing. Sakarmana tam abhyarcha samsiddhim labhate naraha. So, that is explained. Whatever you are doing, you dovetail first. Yeah, 18.46. Yatah pravrittir bhutanam yena sarvam idam tatam svakarmanatam abhyarcha siddhim vindati manavah. By worship of the Lord, who is the source of all beings and who is all pervading, a man can attain perfection through performing his own work. So, whatever we are, we can start adding Krishna into our life and offering him all the results. Complete surrender means to subtract everything other than Krishna from our life. In the beginning it is, yes, we are embroiled in all these worldly activities. In the beginning one is encouraged to add Krishna into his life. But then as he progresses more and more, Krishna should take over his life completely and should subtract everything else that is not about Krishna from his life. So, that is the progression from karma Mishra Bhakti and Jnana Mishra Bhakti and finally Shuddha Bhakti. But if we take to the Shuddha Bhakti directly, we don't have to pass through these stages. But usually many people are, you know, working, they have their jobs and everything. So, you know, dovetail everything in Krishna's service. So, as we do that more and more, then Krishna will give us intelligence how to surrender. Krishna will open will engineer situations for us to surrender also and give us the intelligence how to take advantage of the situations. Everything Krishna will arrange. Dadami buddhi yogam tam. Next question by Bhakta Virendra. If a devotee knowingly or unknowingly is getting indulged in sinful activities, then will he have to pay for his vikarma, or will Lord Krishna will save him since he is performing bhakti? He will be saved from unintentional sins. Not intentional. That is nam aparad. Namno balad hi yasahi papa buddhi. By committing sinful activities on the strength of the holy name of the Lord. That means, oh, let me chant Hare Krishna and then I'll do some nonsense. So I'll neutralize both. So we cannot use holy name for, you know, neutralizing our sins. No. Krishna, the holy name will not submit to our desire. The holy name is non-different from the Lord. The holy name will not submit to our desire. So we have to, any unintentional sins, yes. That is the only way we can be saved from unintentional sins. Otherwise, we have to pay for every single thing. Every single thing. Vanajakshi Mataji. Prabhuji, people may be involved in such karma for daily bread and butter, maybe the shopkeepers or bankers. But if they are devotees, how does such karma work on them? If they are devotees means, they must offer the results of their activities to Krishna. Then it is perfect. Actually speaking, no activity is without fault. Every activity is with fault. In this material world, no activity is without fault. That is explained. I think we have, you see, 18.48. Sahajam karma kaunteya sadosham apinatyajet sarvarambha hi doshena dhumena agnirivavritah. Every endeavor is covered by some fault, just as fire is covered by smoke. Therefore, one should not give up the work born of his nature, O son of Kunti, even if such work is full of fault. Now, that is just half of the answer. The other half is that, yes, one should not give up. But then, if we don't give up, we will be implicated in sin. So what to do? Offer the results to Krishna. Don't give up the work yet, but offer the results to Krishna. What is that? 247? I forgot.
Karmanyevadhikaraste maphaleshu kadachanam makarmaphala heturbhur mate sangostvakarmani.
You have a right to perform your prescribed duty, but you are not entitled to the fruits of action. You are not entitled. Never consider yourself the cause of the results of your activities and never be attached to not doing your duty. Okay, more clearly it is explained in the 3.9.
Yajnyarthat karmano nyatra lokoyam karma bandhanah tadartham karma konteyam muktasanga samachara.
Work done as a sacrifice for Vishnu has to be performed, otherwise work causes bondage in this material world. Therefore, O son of Kunti, perform your prescribed duties for his satisfaction, and in that way you will always remain free from bondage. See, we have to do for his satisfaction. We have to offer the results to him. Yat karoshi yat ashnasi yat juhoshi tadasi yat yat tapasyasi kaunteya tat kurushva madharpanam. We have to do it for Krishna. Only then, yes, we will be free. Next question by Bhaktin Pooja. Is grihastha life is a mess? Because if you are in grihastha, directly or indirectly we support sins to maintain our family members. Because if you are in family, we have to attain proper material education like degrees, so-called doctor, engineer and others. So grihastha is not safe. Okay. It is not necessary that you have to have material education like degrees and doctor, engineer. It's not necessary. We have so many examples of devotees who are grihastha and who are not working like that, who are full-time devotees. That is also there, it is possible. So, grihastha doesn't immediately mean again, you know, we have to go to the materialistic way of life. No need. So, we can have our own land and our own, you know, farm, or we just live in with the temple with the devotees and then fully serve the Lord. So that is possible. But then, of course, not everybody, it takes a lot of austerity to do that. But if one can do that, that is best. But otherwise, yeah, one is directly or indirectly, you know, doing these sins. But again, as I said, no endeavor in this material world is without fault. As it is said, I think we will go back to, go to this purport of this. You see, purport, in conditioned life, all work is contaminated by the material modes of nature. Even if one is a Brahmana, he has to perform sacrifices in which animal killing is necessary. Or maybe now we don't do animal killing sacrifices, but when we are cooking, we are killing some germs here and there, we are stepping on some ants, sometimes killing some cockroaches. General killing is there, no? Similarly, a Kshatriya, however pious he may be, has to fight enemies. He cannot avoid it. Similarly, a merchant, however pious he may be, must sometimes hide his profit and lie to stay in business, or he may sometimes have to do business on the black market. These things are necessary. One cannot avoid them. Similarly, even though a man is a Shudra serving a bad master, he has to carry out the order of the master even though it should not be done. Despite these flaws, one should continue to carry out his prescribed duties, for they are born of his own nature. A very nice example is given herein. Although fire is pure, still there is smoke. Yet smoke does not make the fire impure. Even though there is smoke in the fire, fire is still considered to be the purest of all elements. If one prefers to give up the work of a Kshatriya and take up the occupation of a Brahmana, he is not assured that in the occupation of a Brahmana there are no unpleasant duties. One may then conclude that in the material world, no one can be completely free from the contamination of material nature. This example of fire and smoke is very appropriate in this connection. When in the winter time, one takes a stone from the fire, sometimes smoke disturbs the eyes and other parts of the body. But still one must make use of the fire despite disturbing conditions. You see? Similarly, one should not give up his natural occupation because there are some disturbing elements. Rather, one should be determined to serve the Supreme Lord by his occupational duty in Krishna consciousness. That is the perfectional point. When a particular type of occupation is performed for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord, all the defects in that particular occupation are purified. Apavitraha pavitrova sarvavastham gatopiva yasmaret pundar ekaksham sabahya abhyantara suchihi sabahya abhyantara suchihi. When we remember the Lord, everything inside and outside becomes purified. When the results of work are purified, when connected with devotional service, one becomes perfect in seeing the self within, and that is self-realization. See? So, nothing is pure in this world, but the activity of glorifying the Lord, that will purify everything. So he will shield us from unintentional sins, but intentionally we should not commit. Next question by Bhaktin Manajakshi. Prabhuji, can a devotee transcend from devotional service to jnana and attain his abode, or one should be involved in devotional service irrespective of jara, vyadhi, to cross over the ocean of material samsara? Can a devotee transcend from devotional service to jnana? Well, we've already studied this, that devotional service is the culmination of all jnana. So if one is engaged in devotional service, he is deemed to have already studied everything. All Vedic studies is already deemed done by that person. So he is not transcending from devotional service to something else, some other jnana, no. The highest stratum of transcendence is devotion. One should be involved in devotional service, yes, irrespective of jara, vyadhi, yeah, as much as possible. One, of course, with old age and disease, it will be very difficult, but still we have to stick to our vows and keep to it. Because jara and vyadhi are just preliminary exams, test papers. Practice test papers. So the real test is death. To pass that exam, we have to pass the exam of jara and vyadhi. So these are practice test papers.
How does a devotee, next question by Bhakta Virendra, how does a devotee get transferred to the spiritual world by chanting the holy name of the Supreme Lord at the time of death? Then you wait until the time of death and see how it happens. I don't know. Krishna will come and pick up, no? How he does it, I don't know. We have descriptions in the Bhagavatam that aeroplane will come and Vishnu Dutas will come. Well, if we are fortunate, we will see them. So, we have to qualify ourselves. No? If we have the visa, if we have the flight ticket, we just have to, you know, sit on the plane. And how the other country will be, how, when we go there, let's see how it looks, how he will get transferred. So we have to get sure, make sure that we have to have the ticket. Ticket means we have to, you know, become 100% dedicated servant of spiritual master, Srila Prabhupada. Then only we will have. So how does a devotee's material subtle body gets transformed into spiritual Sachidananda form in the eternal Golok Dham by the mercy of Supreme Lord Krishna? Well, let's see when it happens now. Let's work on our, what we can work on first. How that is going to happen, how this then that, way beyond our control, way beyond our level also. Let's first work on the level that we can work on. The others will automatically follow. Next question by Bhaktin Puja. Only divine souls attract towards the Lord or non-divine souls also attract towards Him. Is any criteria to recognize? Is it pre-planned by God, this soul will serve to God and this or this soul not? Because in some cases the Brahmana family demons present and sometimes dog eaters have bhaktas. Yeah, so we just have to preach. We just have to distribute. And whoever is fortunate, wherever they are coming from, they will take up. Whoever is not fortunate, they will, you know, not take it up. So, how to recognize? Well, we just have to preach. You sow the seeds everywhere. Wherever the land is fertile, the plant will grow. Wherever it is barren, it will not grow. Our thing is to just throw the seeds. So, we have to preach. Next question. Bhakta Virendra. Person from any Hindu caste including Brahmanas, foreigners can become Vaishnavas and it is said Vaishnavism is higher than Brahmanism. Is that the reason why caste Brahmanas oppose Vaishnavas from all castes and of opposing foreign Vaishnavas? The so-called caste Brahmanas are actually brainless people. They don't know what they're doing, they don't know why they're doing, they don't know anything. Basically, so because the caste Brahmin by birth does not exist in the Shastra, so this is something they have concocted. So how can you be situated in a platform of sanity from where you can judge what is correct and what is wrong? So that's why they always come to the wrong understanding and they always belittle or mock at the Vaishnavas. Okay, next. Who? Saundari Uttama Subramanian. Dandavat Prabhuji, Dandavat. Question. If a Karmi get initiated, Diksha Guru receives all sins from that Karmi. Even though after initiation continue sins, how Guru's causeless mercy work? First, let this be very clear that the Diksha Guru must only be a pure devotee in order to be able to receive all the karma and transfer it to Krishna and then neutralize all of them. So, first of all, it has to be Srila Prabhupada. Nowadays in ISKCON, the Diksha Gurus, they are not qualified Diksha Gurus. So, let that be clear first. Having said that, if a Karmi gets initiated by Diksha Guru, okay. Yes, the Guru will take all the sins of the disciple. So, after initiation, if you continue sins, yeah, that's why Srila Prabhupada said, that's why I have some trouble in my health, trouble in my some accident here and there. Prabhupada said, this is because of the rascal devotees, my rascal disciples who are not following. So, a disciple means he must ensure that the devotee, the spiritual master is not put into any difficulty. Not just not put into any difficulty, but to please him. Yasya prasadat bhagavat prasadam. We have to please him. Instead of not pleasing him, if we put him into difficulty. And that is, what kind of disciple is that? Of course, the once one deliberately disobeys the order of the spiritual master is no more obliged to save the devotee. But sometimes the spiritual master may be very merciful and he may, you know, out of his causeless mercy, try to save the disciple. So, but the disciple must be serious not to commit sin. If he is committing sin, means what kind of, he is taking those vows at the time of initiation that he will not commit no meditating, no illicit sex, no gambling, no intoxication. He has to stick by those principles. Otherwise, what is the meaning of initiation? If you are not serious about the whole process, then why take initiation? So, we have to be serious about it. Alright, I think that's the end of the session. Thank you very much. Thank you for your participation. Grantharaj, no, this is Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Anand Kodi Vaishnava Vrind ki jai. Nitai Gaur Premanande. Hari Hari Bol. Hare Krishna.